This video, I'm actually going to be piecing together the tragic history of how Eligio Bishop became who he is today. Between all the lies he's told about how the monster known as Natureboy came to be created. Basically, in this particular part, we're going to go through his childhood. We're going to have interviews not only with Natureboy, but also with his brother, Leonardo, Leo, and his second oldest sister. I don't know what her name is, unfortunately, to help us sort through the mess and find some truths in the middle of Natureboy's madness. Now, we're also going to take a much closer look at Eligio's model stripper escort days. Like, I literally edited clips of Eligio stripping under the name Tyson. And also, I even put Dr., you know, playing Dr. with Dean Willoughby, you know, digging all up in his booty hole. So, Natureboy even had his knees tucked to his chest, no less, by the way. I had to censor some real nasty shit to show you the last two closing scenes. So, if seeing those scenarios is too much, then close out when the stripper scene begins, and I promise you won't miss anything, you know, besides those triple X parts, I promise. And also in part one, I found myself feeling almost sorry for Natureboy, and you might too. But then I produced part two, and I remembered why I hated Eligio so much. So I'm going to put them out ideally together, and the sequel is essential to watch to get the big picture of how and why Eligio Bishop became, you know, the heartless cult leader of many names that he is today, you know, most well known as Natureboy, but I like to call him the Peter Pan of pimp simps, honestly.
There was a boy. A very strange, enchanted boy. They say he wandered very far, very far, over land and sea. A little shy and sad of eye, but very wise was he. And then one day, a magic day, he passed my way. And while we spoke of many things, fools and kings, this he said to me.
Adopted, both of us got adopted, so our last names changed from his name was Prada, my name was Covington, so all of a sudden, both our last names were Bishops.
Okay.
I don't know, I like my last name, Covington. I like my mother's last name. Prada, that kind of just reminds me of a shoe. Or, you feel me, like something expensive, like hold on.
Right.
No, I found out my father had a lot of money. Our father had like over 100,000 stuffed in a recliner. You know me? He was a merchant seizman. And yeah. Facts.
So you all have the same parents, correct?
Yeah.
Okay. And
same mom, different dads, because, you know, the rest of our siblings, you know, different dads. See, Tanya, Lisha, Demetrius, they got two different dads. They got a different dad. See, me and Lee, we got the same dad.
Used to be like a kid, like, what is they talking about?
Oh, remember you used to tell me, they used to say they was going to go make me? Remember they told you, like, we're going to go make your brother go, y'all go sit down, we're going to make a baby. And they used to go in the room and they'd be like, y'all go sit down. We gonna make you a brother or sister. Y'all go. That's what Tanya used to tell me.
And you know he died between mommy and her sister, right?
Really?
they all three slept in bed. They hung out. Everybody hung out. I'll never forget that night or day.
So my dad was with my mother and her sister?
Mm-hmm. Whoa! He was like
that. Nigga was a playboy. Yeah, man. He slept in the bed he slept in the bed with my mother and her sister, my aunt. That nigga played.
Tell me how they used to be fighting over when you say she used to go to knock. Your mama used to be knocking on the door. He knew by the knock.
Oh yeah, you know that. Dum 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 dum.
That means stop having sex.
Mm-mm.
What?
The knock, like it's me.
At what door?
At who?
That's like a little
who was inside?
Her sister door.
Wait, oh, so he was having sex with?
No, like that was the knock to that was mommy or an adult, not us.
Oh, they mean like to put the drugs away or what?
Mm-hmm. Clear the scene. No, like it's cool. Open up, it's me. Oh. Like that was the knock they had to give.
Look how kids know what the fuck going on. He slept in the bed with my mother and her sister, my aunt. That nigga played.
Tell me how they used to be fighting over when you say she used to go to knock. Your mama used to be knocking on the door. He knew by the knock.
Oh yeah, you know that. Dum 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 dum.
That means stop having sex.
Mm-mm.
What?
The knock, like it's me.
At what door?
At who?
That's like a little
who was inside?
Her sister door.
Wait, oh, so he was having sex with?
No, like that was the knock to that was mommy or an adult, not us.
Oh, they mean like to put the drugs away or what?
Mm-hmm. Clear the scene. No, like it's cool. Open up, it's me. Oh. Like that was the knock they had to give.
Look how kids know what the fuck going on.
She still
how the fuck did they thought there was
that knock never left me, because to this day, when me and my kids, when they come home or they on the other side of that door, they do that knock. Mm-hmm. Nobody that knocked on our door did that. Just me and my kids.
Mm-hmm. And it wasn't no mistake with me. They mm-hmm. wanted to make a baby. And they was in love, you said. And it wasn't no mistake with me. They mm-hmm. wanted to make a baby. Mm-hmm. And they was in love, you said.
That was mommy, dude. That was mommy right here. That was mommy, dude. Papi G.
Took his soul.
He raised us. He raised us. And he did not. Mommy used to come off from drugs, come off all high. And he used to be like, oh gosh. She used to be like, your ass, like, sit down somewhere, like, oh, I see me. And he'd be like, come on, we're gonna get dressed. And he'll get us dressed, and he'll go drop us or go meet us with his sister. While my mama get some.
Oh, she, when she was off drugs, she'd be a bitch.
You know, coming off of drugs, you'd be kind of snappy. You know what I'm saying?
Wow.
You'd be real snappy, like, not, you're gonna be well rested. It's like, you gotta take a shower, you gotta do this, might have to take you another little nap, you know, shake that shit completely off. You know, you waking up, you got kids.
I probably got my warmest.
Hit me. Hit me. Yeah. He got my booking. She wouldn't hear that shit. Right. But she after like, yeah, she yeah, hear how like, shit. When I hear that shit. He used to be like, get him dressed. He'd be like, no. Go in the room for this shot. Patricia, that shit used to be so funny. We used to be in the room making fun of him.
How
he
locking talk.
Mhm. Mhm. Demetrius, I tell him, cause him and Demetrius was like this.
Yeah, he used to tell me all kind of shit about mm-hmm. my dad. He like mm-hmm. yo, he like yo, Eligio, your dad was the plug. I'm like, he like, nigga, you know, he been jail. He been in jail. Demetrius has been in jail. My brother been in jail all his life. Mm-hmm. His whole life, in and out of jail. All life. That's all you know is prison. He been incarcerated since a kid.
and it ain't nothing for somebody to be fucking with us right now. We in a situation. That nigga coming, he don't want to talk.
He ready to.
With who? Point him out. Like yeah. What? You know yeah. Who the fuck? You yeah, get it now, like yeah. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, that's crazy. You call.
That's not somebody you call and be like, yeah, this motherfucker won't. No. No.
He don't handle.
Because
he don't come right in.
He want to.
Yeah, get it
popped. Cause getting that time going to jail, I used to tell my brother, nigga, you must got dingling in there. Big old dingling. That nigga lived in jail. That nigga
stayed. Always in prison, bro. Yeah.
That nigga, and he was a fucking police magnet. Then they go piss over there by the dumpster. You know in New York, you go find you a corner person. They same police.
Funny thing, he a tourist like me too. He a tourist like me too.
And y'all got the same birthday.
We got the same April 29th. And we got the same birthday, me and my brother.
Is it you and Demetrius? Or
it's
you
me and
Demetrius.
Me and Demetrius got the same birthday.
Got the same birthday, different year. Isn't yeah. That crazy?
Wow. Paradigms are crazy.
Yeah, me and my older brother got the same birthday.
He was living in so many different dimensions.
That nigga, he a little scary too when you around him.
Yeah, we all come like.
I remember him just staring at me. I'm like. Fuck on
hey,
you,
let me
man.
Tell you something. He that nigga right there. I don't know. He had like an imbalance about him. Cause that snap like that. I'm talking about real life snap. Like my mother had him in the psychiatric ward. Snap.
Yeah, he a little scary to be around.
Call him and, yeah.
He a little scary. Like you feel a little nervous around
and
him.
And being that he
like, big nigga too. That nigga big. What he like 6'3", 6'4"? Demetrius yeah, is big as shit.
He was in and out of jail all this time.
Scary looking too.
That's his thing.
Yeah.
He have to.
I was born in Metropolitan. My dad was 60 when he had me. My mom was like 34. When I was born, I was a crack baby. My mom died when I was a baby. First, my father died. She woke up in the bed, and my dad died in his sleep. He had a heart condition. He died. She woke up. This was the love of her life. My dad was like a sugar daddy to my mom. And I think that's what I was told. He was older. But she was in love with him. My dad's Puerto Rican. My mom's Haitian. And my dad brought a lot of happiness in my mom's life. He had money and he would take her places. He was in love with her, from what I was told. All I know is that I never remember seeing them. I never remember seeing my mother or father. They died when I was one. My family did not come get me. Not my uncle, not my aunt. Not my grandmother, nobody. I was born in 82. And so my mom and dad died in the same year. And I was put into foster care as a baby. And I've been on my own my whole life with no family. I have a little brother who was with me. But my whole life, I've been passed around from foster home to foster home. And I'm at the age of 14, at the age of like 12, I was adopted by the bishops and shipped to Jersey, New Jersey, Willowboro, New Jersey, where shortly after I was abused by them. I left that situation. By the time I was 14, I went to a group, like between 12 and 14, I was in group homes. They took me out of that home because I kept running away. Then I went to group homes. My name is Eligio Prado. Eligio Prado. I was adopted by the bishops. Eligio Bishop now. My mom and dad died when I was one. I never seen them a day in my life until I was like 27 and somebody sent me a picture of them. I don't know what my grandmother looks like. I don't know what my aunts, uncles look like. I've been on my own my whole life. I was in foster care up until I was 12 years old. Then at 12, I got adopted by the bishops in Willowboro, New Jersey. I was raised in many foster homes in the Bronx, Harlem. I was a part of an agency called Harlem Downing. I never forget them. And they would ship us from different homes to homes. So I grew up very confused, not knowing who I was and not having an identity because I didn't know who my family was.
I just remember being in different homes all growing up, just different homes, and no one never looking like me, and just being in somebody else's home. I never had like a biological family. And my later on, I went to search for my biological family, and I'll tell you about that later and what I found. No one took me in. No one took us in, and so we went from foster home to foster home. Now, at the age of, I would say around 11, 12, I was adopted. I was living in the Bronx, raised in New York, raised in the Bronx. About 11, 12, I was adopted in New Jersey, Willowboro, New Jersey. I was adopted there. When I went there, it was adopted by the bishops, who were abusive. The bishops were abusive. They was in Willowboro, New Jersey. They was very, these people were very abusive. We didn't know that because when we went to visit, it was so nice because it was like grass, and we went to visit on the weekend at first. We were foster kids in the Bronx by this lady named Miss Dukes. And I lived on 300 Morris Ave in the Bronx. And I was raised in that project building like right there for a long time. This lady, you know, we was, this is during the hip hop era. I'm growing up through hip hop, you know what I'm saying? And it was different. There was no internet. TV went off. We had Nintendo. We had Game Boys. It was different back then. It was a whole nother world I was coming up in. And anyway, fast forward, and let me tell you about one of the experiences I had when I was split up by my brother when I was about 6 years old. In Queens, I could remember a guy named Mr. Pope. I remember forget Mr. Pope. But I was always a, when I say I was a horny child, like I was humping on things, and I had sexual urges very young. Very young in age, I've had sexual urges. I was humping on like anything I could find. Like I remember looking at The Simpsons and getting horny over The Simpsons. Like I was horny over Marge and shit, and I was looking at Lisa and shit like that. And I would hump on things, whether it was another kid. It didn't matter if it was a boy or a girl. And I was staying in this family. This is when my sexuality started to kick in, because I was staying in Queens. Me and my brother got separated because we was like fighting each other all the time. And when I was a little kid, you know, it was very confusing for me growing up, you know, not understanding things, because I just logged in. I was just responding to what I was feeling and things going on. So as a child, uneducated about my sexuality, I pretty much, you know, was humping on the other kids in the foster home, you know, just to get my rocks off or just to feel something, you know what I'm saying? And he caught me one day. Mr. Pope, the dude I got separated from my foster father, he caught me, and basically the dude just made me do sexual acts with another boy that I was already humping on anyway. And so he made me put my penis in his mouth, take a picture. He took a picture. He said, put the boy's penis in my mouth. He took a picture. He said, if you do anything, if you say anything about this, I'm pretty much going to tell the social worker. I got separated and I got sent to Queens, where I was molested by this guy named Mr. Pope. I'm gonna be honest with you, I wouldn't even know if I would say I was molested, because I was always sexually curious, even as a child. I was always like sexually curious. I was almost humping. I was very sexual as a child. Like I was very curious, like, about my sexuality. Kind of like a savior trying to find act like, well, what I learned, like, sex with me,
you know what I'm saying? Just get having figuring me out, like, ooh, this feels good, so let me do it. Huh. So I was always, I don't know, humping on something. You know what I'm saying? So I can remember that, and I can remember him seeing that energy in me and then taking advantage of it. Seeing my, you know, I remember him taking advantage of that and, like, taking pictures.
Like, I don't know, as a kid, I thought it was bad I did, and so I was, like, I was really scared. I didn't know. That's why I was really afraid. But so one day, you know, we went to the foster agency, Harlem Downing is the name of the foster company that I used to be a part of growing up. Harlem Downing on 125th in St. Nick. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, we went to, I'll never forget the lady. Her name is Miss Boss. I'll never forget the lady, Miss Boss. And Miss Boss, I went to her and I told her, listen, I'm scared. I don't want to go back with this guy. I don't want to go back with him because he did something to me and I don't want to go back to him. I want to go with my brother. And the lady, I got along with the lady and she was like, okay. And then the lady, next thing you know, she brings me to office with the guy. You know what I'm saying? With Mr. Pope. And I'm like, oh shit. She's like, you got to say this in front of him. And I'll never forget my universe doing that to me because I was really scared. Maybe I was like 6-7 years old. I'll never forget. And I went inside to this lady and I was like, damn. And I told him, I stuck up for myself at such a young age. I was so proud of myself. And she took me out of this man's house immediately. And they put me back with my brother in the Bronx, on Morris Ave. I was so happy to be back with my little brother. It was fun, da da da. Then me and him, late shortly after, we got adopted by some people named the Bishops. You know what I'm saying? The Bishops would adopt us. And would adopt us for the wrong reasons. So we got there, we thought it was all good. They was really nice to us. They took us to the farm. It was like, you know, Jersey. It was Jersey, baby. It was South Jersey, from New York, South Jersey. It was like a beautiful, it was nature out there. We had bikes. We was loving it. Like, we was loving it. We didn't want to go back to New York. We went there for the weekend. And then me and my bro came back to New York on the weekdays to go to school. But we drove every weekend to go there to just test out how the transition would be. And we told them, well, we want to go back. They was treating us so nice. It was so beautiful there. We had a pear tree and an apple tree in our backyard. We was the only one on the block with a pear tree, apple tree. She had a garden. She told us how to garden and all that. It was beautiful, right? So, then, you know what I'm saying? We got adopted. As soon as we got adopted, the shit changes. They start treating us like different. Miss Bishop starts treating us like real fucking mean. The Bishop lady, she starts treating us real mean. So Miss Bishop was a cancer. And she was diabetic. And every time her sugar got low, she would go into these episodes of throwing our clothes, just waking us up in the middle of the night, snapping. Like, this lady was crazy, yo. But the funny thing is, like, you know what I'm saying? Like, everything happened for a reason. I'm going to go back into that later. You feel what I'm saying? So she used to, like, basically abuse us. Like, basically, this is what the lady did. I found this out later. Like, she adopted us. She used to hold her home open for, like, patients, OCD patients. Like, it was basically adults that had, like, they were a little slow. They had mental issues, and she would get paid to take care of these people. You know what I'm saying? And these people were slow in their house. So her house was, like, a place where, you know, she had us as foster kids or adopted kids, and she had, you know, these clients. She called the clients. They were like people that were grown, but they were kind of slow, and they got SSI checks, and she got paid to take care of them. This is how they made their living. They take care of these people. You know what I'm saying? These are adults. They were OCD clients or something like that, occupational something clients or some shit. But what they did with me and my brother Leo is basically, they took us out of regular school. They put us on medication. We started taking a short bus to school because they took us out of regular school. We wasn't bad kids. She just did that on purpose. She said we was emotionally disturbed. She put us on Ritalin so that she can get paid for us too. So it was a hustle for her. You know, getting kids was a hustle for her. You feel me? She didn't adopt us for any good reasons. She adopted for, this is what the universe would be do. You feel what I'm saying? Like, this is the luck I have. So My mom and dad died. None of my family comes. So I never had no connection to a family. And then the family that I did get adopted by, they adopted me for financial reasons as a hustle. So they took us out of regular school so they can get an SSI check. They put us on medication, Ritalin, so they can get an SSI check for us. And they was getting paid like wild money to take care of us. So they made us special, you know what I'm saying, special ed children. And so, you know, this puts me involved in around kids that was just rebellion. And I was like, fuck it. I was doing what they was doing. And you know what I'm saying? And I just started being bad, like just being bad. Like, you know what I mean? I was always good at basketball. Really good at basketball. I wanted to be a basketball player. So this Miss Bishop used to do wild shit to us. She used to like make us like sleep in a room with no lights. You feel me? She made us like there was no light in our room. You know what I mean? Like it was no TV, nothing, just darkness. And we had to use the light from the hallway to shine in and do what we needed to do in the room if it was nighttime. And she would always put like, she would always tell me that because I was dark skinned that I was dirty. Like she was like, you're dirty. Like she used to put like Ajax all over me in a tub and make me scrub my skin. She's like, so for a minute, I thought I was a demon because she said my name meant legion. She said, you're a demon. She used to tell me, this is what Maisha was talking about when she said that I thought that I was a demon. I told her that when I was a child because Miss Bishop told me I was a demon, that my name mean legion, like it means a demon. So I was scared of my own self and my own reflection in the mirror because she told me I was a demon as a child. And she used to make me like wash my skin off. And I was thinking that my skin was dirt. In my head, psychologically, she told me this. She like, you're dark skin because you're dirty. And so I thought it was normal to wash my skin with Ajax, but it wasn't going nowhere. So in my mind growing up, I thought something was wrong with me. I thought this lady was telling me that, you know, I'm a demon. And so I thought something was wrong with me. You see what I'm saying? Until later I understood like what the fuck was going on. But the lady told me like, yo, she used to like put rudely too, just throw it on my face, like put it all over my body. And she would like put this much water in the tub and make me wash in that water and scrub me with like a, you know what I'm saying? Sometimes she would use all kinds. She was just really abusive. She would like hit me while this lady was like doing wild, crazy shit. One time, she always make us like clean up and stupid shit like that and do dumb shit. And like we had to eat at a separate table. Like, just, you know what I mean? They didn't let us touch the kitchen. They was like, yo, you know what I'm saying? Like they made us come take our pills. We came and take our pills with our water and our food. We took our medicine with our food and shit. Like, she made us sit on the other side. We had to stay in the backyard. And every now and then, the farthest we can go was to the park. You know what I'm saying? The park was up the block and it had a basketball court. So that's all I could do was play basketball all day. So I got really good at that shit. So I, you know, just, that was it. And we had to be back to the crib. Took us to school. When I was going to school, it was funny for me because all the kids had parents. And I was looking at them and putting shit together like, yo, these people's parents really loved them. You know what I'm saying? Like, you could tell. You know what I'm saying? Like, because of how kids were at school, they was different than us. And my world was confusing growing up because it was like, wait, you're dark-skinned. You must be dirty, too. And I started putting shit together. I used to think, like, dark-skinned people were dirty. You know what I'm saying? And it was fucking crazy, my nigga. Like, I had to wake up. Like, it was on some other shit, this lady. You know what I'm saying? So basically, you know what I'm saying, she used to beat me for no reason, just because her sugar was low. She is a diabetic, so she used to beat us for no reason, like, threw my brother down the steps sometime. And if she think, if we was in a room sleeping, and she thought somebody was talking, she would, like, hear stuff. And she'd come in there, we was dead ass asleep, and she'd be like, get your ass up. And she'd start tearing out the drawers, and we like, yo, he wasn't talking. Like, you know, one time, like, she bust me in the head. I still got this scar on my head. She bust me in the head with a buckle. My shit started bleeding. This lady was wild, crazy where her sugar got low. She just went through these episodes. It was Pentecostal. It was Pentecostal church. She had beat the Bible into us. Like, basically, like, she had beat it into us. Like, you know what I mean? Made us pray. Like, forced us to get on our knees and pray. And, like, it was crazy. We had to paint the church. It was crazy. Like, growing up was wild, crazy. You know what I'm saying? Like, Miss Bishop was a quite crazy lady.
You know, my father's last name was Prada. My name was Eligio Prada. And then I got adopted and become a Eligio Bishop. And when I got adopted, the bishops had took us out of regular school and put us in. They took us out of the regular school system and put us in alternative school. Put us on Ritalin so that they can get a check for us.
Times on Sunday, Bible study on Tuesday, YPWW meetings on Thursday, choir rehearsal on Friday. We found out that they would caught the Holy Ghost in front of Miss Tate. She gave us vanilla wafers after church.
Hallelujah.
So we catch it every Sunday.
Hallelujah.
That's my mama.
That ain't your mama. You said the other lady was yours.
I changed. Boy, you can't change.
That's my mama.
Nigga. Nigga, you hear me calling you? I said nigga.
Yes, my dear, here I come.
Get your behinds down here. And I told you not to mess up your clothes. Nadine?
Yes?
We're going to be downtown at the social service office.
Right.
20, you stay with Nadine.
Yes.
Man, after the bishops, like, me and him started off cool. Like, we in the bishops. He started whipping out the belts, and like, he just went that way.
So, even as a child, did he ever display anything that was concerning, you know, that would be something that would be concerning to someone?
Yeah, the bishops, yeah. Yeah, he, you know, running away, you know, it just returned to me. I don't know. I didn't want to, like, get my ass beat up if I did something wrong or, you know, chastise me. Only God loved the ones where he chastised. So I didn't take it as a bad note. I was like, I don't have to do that no more because I can't sit down.
Okay, did the post come before or after the bishops? Hold on, y'all.
Come on, Olivia. I'm sorry, go ahead.
I said, did the popes come before or after the bishops?
You said before or after what?
Did the popes come before or after the bishop?
Like after.
Okay.
It just kind of went haywire after. Like with the bishops, it was like a different, it turned to a different person. And then after all that shit jumped off, we got separated. I stayed. And I was going back and forth to New York, to Jersey. They were just, I guess, testing us out. Then I stayed in Jersey, and he went the other way. And all right, that's how that.
So do you think that the popes had anything to do with the violation or the molestation that he said that he went through?
Yeah, that probably took a toll on, I think that would probably take a toll on anybody.
Mm.
I'm sorry that had happened, but I don't know. It was just like, wow, fucked up.
Wow.
I'm sad that that happened to him. I would have turned out to be a different person. But,
yeah.
I don't know. So in the Lord's hands, man.
So.
But that's fine.
So did he have, like, have you ever known for your brother to be sexually active with animals?
I really can't say anything about that. I really can't. Animals.
I'm asking because he's made statements before.
I don't know about that.
Yo, lady, fucking yo, that's.
my penis. Now a lot of people hear that and record that. They gon' see this nigga crazy. They gon' see this nigga crazy. They gon' see this nigga crazy. But I want y'all to know I'm letting that shit out, because I want people to know, like, yo, it's the type of shit that we be going through. And it might not be your personal thing that you did, but you did something that you would never say to nobody. But it was some weird shit you did, bro. And until you able to talk about that shit openly, you're right, I'm not one of you. Cause I could be real with myself. Do I crave having the dog lick me now? Fuck no.
Then, after that, I got adopted. Shortly after, I went to group homes. Then from group homes, I went to residentials. From the residentials, I went to Jamesburg for boys. In Jamesburg, I was in Jamesburg, and at 16, they shipped me to Rahway. Then I got out at 18, 19 years old. And when I was in jail, I tried to kill myself. I was young. I didn't know how to do that time. And I was into a lot of DMX. And DMX, he had me thinking I was like Dark Man X. It was crazy. So back then, so before I got out, they had to give me a psychiatric evaluation. So I had to go to a psych hospital. From there, I left there and I went into life. But I come to life at the age of 19 with no mother, no father, no aunt, no uncle, no nothing. I'm by myself in this world, trying to figure things out. There was a CO lady that was in love with me, and she took me in after I got out of jail. And then my brother's friend let me come stay with him. And I've been on, people have been helping me take care of me since I got out. So from the age of 19, when I got out of jail, I've been on my own. To this day, I have no family. I'm on my own. I have my little brother, a couple people that I know. I have my biological sisters, which were, we didn't grow up together. They have half brother, half sisters. I've known of them, but we wasn't close. But I've been on my own my whole life. I want to let you know that. So after I got out of jail, I went to try out in the military because I had nowhere to live. It was hard because I had no family. So I went to an institution so I can have somewhere to stay. I went to the military. I got through basic training, AIT. They found out I had psychiatric background. So I had an honorable discharge. They let me go out of the honorable discharge.
He got dishonorable or honorable discharge? Wait, hold on, wait. You said he got dishonorable discharge or honorable discharge?
Dishonorable. Oh. He's being honorable. Right? Yo, get out of here. No. He was trying to get me to go to the army. I'm not going to nobody army.
I went to Job Corps. I completed Job Corps because Job Corps would give me somewhere to stay. So I stayed and lived in Job Corps. I had to be good, so I had somewhere to stay. It motivated me to stay there in Job Corps. When I got out of Job Corps, I completed it, but I had nowhere to live. I had nowhere to go. And so someone told me, you should be a model because you look like Tyson Beckford. And I researched who Tyson Beckford was. And I said, wow, this guy's making a lot of money. Which then took me into the exotic entertainment field, the sex industry. So I was broke all my life. I've been poor my whole life, just trying to figure out how to make it my whole life. And so there's a video surfacing, and I was young, and I did that for some money. I did it. It wasn't $50. I did it for actually $2,000. The video that you seen of me, I was poor, but I ain't have no. I didn't know there was gonna be an internet back then. It was so long ago. I did that so as to survive in the world. I was living with different women. I was living home to home, sleeping on people's couches. And the sex industry gave me a way to have money for myself so that I can do what I need to survive in this world. And when I was in prison, after that, just figuring shit out, I tried to get into modeling. I did a couple of things doing modeling, but it wasn't enough to make money. So I had odd jobs here and there, trying to make it, living with people, renting rooms, just trying to make it in the world. But I've been all alone my whole life. People have come along and helped me along the way. There's been girls that has been my girlfriend that let me come live with them and stuff like that, but pretty much been on my own my whole life. And so getting into the sex industry of being a stripper, it gave me the liberty to make money to become on my own.
Under normal circumstances, I wouldn't ask y'all for a like, a subscribe, a comment, but tonight I deserve it. I was trying to dig up the Dean Willoughby video. You know, the playing doctor video with Eligio, and I found it. And it was even worse than I ever heard. And then I also found this Tyson video. And I just had to show you guys because it's hilarious. But also, you know, during the process of censoring it, I had to see like Eligio's gooch, his taint, like way too many times. I really think I've got some PTSD as a result of this, and you know, y'all need to look out for me. The first thing he's gonna do, you know, just to warn you, is act like he needs to pick something up off the ground so he can bend over. I had to put this See No Evil monkey up because he was bending over, busting it open. And for quite some time, too. Like I said, I'm traumatized. I don't think this video was made with straight women in mind. You know, it doesn't do anything for me. But if it does anything for you, no judgments here. Who does he think he is, R. Kelly in the Down Low video? We know he's always a designer imposter. And as I mentioned, at this time, he was going by Tyson. And he impersonated Tyson. Like, for real, for real. I did not put the flame on there because he's hot. It's because he's burning. Man who posed as Lexington doctor gets 15 years. Dean Allen Willoughby, who pleaded guilty to numerous counts of practicing medicine without a license, sexual abuse, and other charges in May, was sentenced to 15 years in prison on Friday. Flanked by defense attorneys Scott Hayworth and Jim Lowry, Willoughby, a Mount Sterling resident and owner of a music publishing company, stood before Fayette Circuit Judge Pamela Goodwine. Willoughby's knees buckled when Goodwine told him his sentence. He was immediately placed in a court prisoner holdover room. Lexington police have said Willoughby, 45, posed as a doctor doing medical research and paid people, many of them homeless men, $50 each to examine their prostates, check for hernias,
and inject them with what they thought were vitamins. Some of the charges against him dated back to incidents that occurred as long ago as 1996, according to police. Willoughby had an office on Corporate Drive in Lexington, where men from the Catholic Action Center shelter and elsewhere were examined, according to police. According to investigators, Dr. Dean paid $20 to those who brought others to him to be examined.
The greatest thing you'll ever learn is just to love and be loved in return. Thing you'll ever learn is just to love and be loved in return.